Good afternoon, Prime Minister, ladies and gentlemen. A very warm welcome back to the second half of our conference, Business Europe Day 2016, Reform to Perform. This morning, we talked about the challenges facing Europe from the outside in, as it were, those external factors. Then we talked about what we need to do from the inside out to meet those challenges. Later, we're going to talk about how to live up to that mantra of being big on the big things. But it's now my great pleasure and honour to give the floor to Mark Rutte, Prime Minister of the Netherlands and the man in the EU presidency hot seat. A very warm welcome, sir.
Well, Madam President, ladies and gentlemen, a few weeks ago I was in Silicon Valley. And for decades, it's been the promised land for any business offering online, digital, and high-tech products and services, as we all know. I was there to promote the Dutch Startup Delta Initiative. In my discussions with young entrepreneurs from the Netherlands before my trip, I noticed a recurring theme, one that is very relevant for this particular event. For them, the EU single market is not a very attractive prospect. In fact, they tend to associate Europe with rules and regulations. Often, they are not aware of the opportunities that European cooperation offers. So, when they spread their wings, they look to the US or the Far East instead of their neighbors. These faraway markets seem more relevant, more attractive, and particularly easier to break into than the one with 500 million consumers on their doorstep. And I believe we should take two lessons from this. First, that the US, Singapore, China, and the rest of the world are forging ahead, and they won't wait around for Europe. In an ever more digital and footloose global economy, you need to be alert and act quickly. Secondly, our fantastic single market still needs a major push if you want to exploit its full potential. And we need to do more than we are doing currently now. A lot more. If there's one thing paradoxically, let us be crystal clear. Over the past few decades, the free movement of people, goods, capital and services has allowed EU member states to prosper. Take the Netherlands, for example. Thanks to the single market, my country, despite being relatively small, is now the world's fifth biggest exporter. More than three quarters of all our exports go to other EU countries. And that's why I always stress that for us, the single market is vital. If it didn't exist, we'd have to invent it. At the same time, the perfect, completed single market is still a long way off. We've all heard stories of regulatory barriers and red tape. Construction businesses have to deal with 115 different EU directives and regulations on top of national and local rules. Trains traveling between member states still have to change drivers at the border because their national qualifications aren't recognized. And professions like baker and photographer are still regulated in some member states. These are also features of the single market, or rather, the lack of it. And they should motivate us to make improvements. You have perhaps heard me say this a lot recently, but further bolstering and completing the single market is one of the Dutch presidency's top priorities. Because making full use of a comprehensive, fair, single market benefits everyone. If we exploited the single market's full potential, we would have an extra 1.25 trillion euros to play with. That's twice the size of the Dutch economy. And it would create millions of vital jobs that would give many people a fair and honest wage. And so, indeed, it is a question of reform to perform, which is today's theme. But it is equally important that we comply to perform, that we roll up our sleeves and comply with previous agreements, like moving forward with the implementation of the Services Directive. The fact is, the EU services market is still largely untapped, despite being the sector most Europeans work in. There are still too many unexploited sectors like retail, business services, and indeed construction that have been ready for a real single market for years. The frameworks are in place. It's now just a question of doing it, of complying to perform. And if we want the European economy to keep performing, we must stay open to new opportunities and invest in innovation. Or to use the terminology of this meeting, we must also innovate to perform. Take the field of energy and climate, for instance. Here, new revenue models and markets are opening up around the world. After the ambitious Paris Climate Agreement, we need the innovative power of the single market to make Europe a world leader in clean energy. Or take the possibilities of the digital single market. In the digital age, Europe must aim to compete with American giants like Facebook and Google. We must make sure that our own startups can grow into major players and create jobs here in Europe. The single market is the main instrument to help us to do this. My good friend and former EU Commissioner Nelly Kroes, now the Dutch Special Envoy for Startups, has put forward an interesting proposal, an EU startup visa. It aims to make it easier for non-EU entrepreneurs to start new businesses in Europe without having to apply to each member state separately. It's a simple but very useful idea that will help create a flourishing climate for business and innovation in the EU. But to make ideas like this a reality, regulation and the market must keep pace with technological advances. And these are happening at the moment at warp speed. So, more and more, we'll have to think differently and look further ahead. Regulation should leave more scope for innovation and flexibility. Innovations often happen so fast that any new laws and rules need to consider factors whose existence or significance we aren't even aware of yet. More than ever, new technologies and business models dictate the flow of our markets. So our common rules should both fit and facilitate innovation. Let me give you an example. A short while ago, someone in the Dutch city of Utrecht used a drone to capture some beautiful footage of the city's iconic Dom Tower in the mist. Since then, a million people have viewed the clip online. But the filmmaker was fined 350 euros, which was a bit of a damper. So what happened? Drones, as we know, are fairly new as a feature in public spaces. We had no rules for them at first, and we wanted to prevent accidents, so the rules for model aircraft were applied to drones. According to those rules, the filmmaker should have applied for a permit for his drone flight on that day. He didn't have a clue. 5 years ago, no one could predict the need to regulate the use of drones. Now we do, and the use of drones is increasing at warp speed. And this shows that the legislative process almost never matches the speed of technological change. The European Commission is, of course, working hard to make all aspects of the single market stronger, more effective, and more attractive. A lot is happening already, and there's lots more in the pipeline. That is something I want to emphasize today. Take the strategies on both the single market and the digital single market, which, quite rightly, have a clear focus on SMEs and startups. Or take First Vice President Timmermans' better regulation agenda, or the innovation-friendly regulation agenda led by Commissioner Moedas. They're all leading us in the right direction. I particularly support one part of these plans, the innovation principle. And this principle requires assessing as standard the impact of proposed new legislation on innovation. In my view, we should position the innovation principle more prominently in the years ahead to make the EU economy stronger and more agile. I had applause here in my text. Thank you. I thought this was a good part. So, we do have a lot of work ahead of us. And we have got a lot of balls in the air at once. During the Dutch presidency, the Netherlands wants to work with the Commission to achieve progress on as many issues as possible. And as always in the EU, we'll achieve our goals schritt für schritt, step by step. We must make it easier to shop online in other member states, attune legislation to the digital age, and tackle unfair geo-blocking. In the market for services, the Dutch presidency will also be asking member states to take a good look at the need to regulate professions. And the introduction of the service passport will reduce the number of barriers, stopping service providers operating in other member states. These are only a few examples from a long list of things to do that will help the European economy perform more effectively. But it's wrong to see this as only an issue for the Commission, or the presidency holder for that matter. EU action is only one side of the coin. It's also up to the member states to seize opportunities and sustain economic growth. The single market's strategic agenda sets out the areas where each member state can make these improvements. So there's nothing to stop us enhancing the single market ourselves by quickly following up on these country-specific recommendations. And of course, the private sector and the research community also have a major role to play. National and EU authorities can and must stimulate innovation and entrepreneurship. But we won't get far without specialist knowledge and a strong market. Government, research, and the market need one another, because true innovation often happens at the nexus of the public interest, new business solutions, and ongoing scientific research. And it's here, at this nexus, that government, business and science find themselves working together for common goals. In the Netherlands, we call this the triple helix. Innovation deals are one way of making this partnership a reality. Innovation deals are voluntary agreements between government, business and knowledge institutions. They stimulate innovation without requiring changes to legislation. The deals are inspired by the Dutch Green Deals, practical agreements on creating a circular economy concluded in the past 5 years. Recently, for example, regional authorities and more than 50 companies agreed to reduce the costs of offshore wind energy by 40% by 2020. This shared goal can only be achieved with innovative solutions. And if all the parties work as allies with a shared aim. Let me give you another example. With an aging population, the Netherlands is currently seeking ways to contain the cost of healthcare, a problem that many countries are facing today. The use of advanced robotics is one way to help us improve both personal care and efficiency in public health. Amsterdam's Free University recently tested a robot called Alice, which helps elderly people who suffer from Alzheimer's. And they all love Alice. So together with public and private parties, we are planning to scale up robotics testing and to make it profitable for everyone. I believe a fine example of the triple helix and a promising business case for the Dutch life sciences and health sector. Ladies and gentlemen, if you're really serious to maximize the European economy's performance, we need to reform. But we need to comply and innovate just as much. To me, this boils down to one task that concerns us all, maximizing the power of the single market, in particular, the services market and the digital market. We need member states that don't wait for the Commission to act, but work to improve their own, and as a result, Europe's performance. We need businesses, governments, and knowledge institutions to approach each other with real plans and real projects. During its presidency, the Netherlands is making a practical contribution by hosting a special TEDx event entitled Ideas from Europe on the 31st of March in the Knights Hall in The Hague. The event will bring together innovative ideas, policymakers, and investors in 12 inspiring TED Talks. The Commission has decided to make this an annual event, and I can highly recommend it. The Dutch presidency of the Council of the European Union runs until the end of June, and I am determined that by then we will set out the many opportunities before us in a concrete agenda. And that's why I invite you, the European business community, to tell us where you feel where national and EU legislation still falls short. Tell us where the EU and member states can promote innovation more. And tell us about the opportunities we collectively are missing today. Only by having that discussion will we gradually, step by step, make the single market an even bigger success. Thank you.
Prime Minister, thank you. Thank you so very much indeed, sir. What you have said will be music to this audience's ears. When you talked about reforming to perform, we've been discussing precisely those priorities for the future. Complying to reform, we've been talking about the crucial. It's about enforcement. It's about implementing what you said you'd do as much as looking at new things. And when you talk about innovating to perform, we've been talking about those drivers for competitiveness, what makes that investment ecosystem and the innovation principle. And you underline the urgency. I've been asking all our panels to give me one priority, one key next step for the future. We will report back on what they tell me. Thank you so much for being with us. We're very grateful. Thank you.